Good afternoon. I'd like to start out this afternoon by thanking Jonathan Casey and the museum for inviting me here today. I did bring one prop, and that is my husband and I are military collectors, and while this did not belong to my doughboy, it did belong to a soldier in World War I. So an actual helmet that was used. All right, I have to put it on for just a minute. A little big for me. You might wonder how I got interested in pandemic influenza. There we go. I became interested in influenza really very early on. And the reason are these two people right here. This is my grandfather, Carl C. Siegel, and his first wife, Mary Virginia DeHaven Siegel. They both got the flu in 1919, in the spring of 1919, and she didn't make it. So 8 years later, he remarried my grandmother. So I can truly say, if it were not for the influenza epidemic, I wouldn't be here. I just want to give you a real brief overview of what we'll be talking about today. And that is a little bit of the war and the disease and how those two interacted, how our government tried to counteract the disease and its rapid spread across the United States, and what that meant for us afterward, and what it still means for us today. But first, let's look at that sentence, or that phrase up there. 1918 Spanish influenza epidemic. Does anybody know what's wrong with that sentence, or that phrase? That's right. Actually, it didn't just occur in 1918. It was from 1918 all the way through to 1920, and I'll show you the timeline a little bit more. Secondly, it wasn't Spanish. The Spanish were kind of unlucky in this case, and we'll talk about that in a minute. But indeed, it also really wasn't an epidemic. Instead, it was the most extensive and lethal global pandemic this planet has ever experienced. Obviously, this is the centennial of the outbreak of the flu. And you might have heard different numbers in terms of what scientists believe, how many people died, and those numbers are changed dramatically. And we'll talk a little bit about why that is, why the numbers are different and how that's changed. And quite frankly, the short answer is science. We have determined a lot more, we've learned a lot more, so that the handout I gave you has two things in it. The first is a timeline to give you a rough idea of what happened primarily in the United States from the early 1918 through the middle of 1920. And the second thing I gave you was a bibliography, and that is some of the best resources I have found on the disease, and the ones in bold are my favorites. So what do we know now that we didn't know then? Well, at that point, we didn't know that it was a virus. They truly believed, their best guess was that it was caused by bacteria. But today we know that it was caused by a unique avian or bird virus. Now, birds carry the flu, but they don't get sick themselves. They can give it to pigs, but right now, scientists believe that the 1918 epidemic did not come from pigs. Much has changed in the last 25 years, and I have dates of significance on the bottom of this slide. I'm not going to talk about each and every one of those, but if you'll look through your timeline, you'll see why some of those were important. I'll highlight a few as we go through, but I only get 45 minutes, so I can't cover everything. Okay, what was life like when this occurred? Well, things had dramatically improved. Society was on the move. We now had cars. That was the major change. But not just automobiles, mechanization on farms and tractors. Things were moving faster because of the ability to use machines. Less than 50% of the population in the United States, however, were city dwellers. Most of us still lived in rural areas. However, with mechanization, with automobiles, with all of the advances, individuals really had an opportunity to meet with one another a lot more often than they had in the past. And what that means is that people could join clubs, they went to town to go to church, they went to town to get groceries beyond just their subsistence living. Men and women joined organizations, for fraternal organizations, social clubs. Almost every small town had a band or two. Most of our information was given to us on oftentimes somewhat of a 24-hour news cycle. It just was a little different than we see it today, and that was newspapers. Most towns had at least a twice-daily newspaper, and some larger towns, including Kansas City, had not only competing newspapers, but newspapers that were delivered as many as 5 times a day. That's how news moved. Oh, and of course, when people liked it, we had telephones, and we had party lines. That meant that you found out the town's gossip simply by picking up the phone and listening in. Life was moving in a much more positive direction. People were seeing progress, the ability to improve their lives. And the final thing is that there was a wide spectrum of quality differentiation in medical care. What does that mean? Well, it means that some doctors didn't really believe in bacteria or germs. They still believed a lot of the older thoughts about medical practices, which meant people were treated differently by the medical personnel throughout the world, really. So the war. War breaks out in 1914, officially beginning in August, and the United States remains neutral until April 1917. At that point, we decide we have to engage to help end the stalemate. In order to do that, we provide the forces. And that meant 3 drafts in the United States, the first in June 1917, the second in June 1918, and the third, September 12, 1918. Well, why do those dates matter? We'll look in a moment when you see the timeline for the flu. But the number of individuals that were drafted is rather staggering, I think, when we look back. We're talking about 24 million American men and young men, oftentimes, being drafted into the war and, of course, doing what first? Going to training camps. There were 32 spread across the United States, and many of them held 25 to 50,000 troops at any given time. That meant those camps were decidedly crowded. Now, what about the home front? What did that mean for the rest of us? Well, all of our lives were focused exclusively on war. That meant raising money for war. That meant supporting the war in every form. That meant the creation of new organizations, like the Food Administration, the Fuel Administration, all of which dictated how much and when we could use certain items. Bond drives. Bond drives weren't basically, hey, could you please give us some money so we can support the war? They were decidedly very definitive in terms of who had to give what. And what that means is there was a competition created between states, between counties, and even down to city blocks. And that meant there were block captains who monitored contributions. You went to the bank to make a contribution, but somehow your block captain still knew how much you gave. And people were shamed for not giving what others considered enough. And you see on this slide, a bond slacker is a Kaiser backer. Saving is not sacrificing. With hindsight now, we know that the war ended in November 1918, but that was not at all assured. And what that means is American forces were needed, and we knew they were needed. So American boys were stuffed onto overcrowded troop ships and sent to France and Britain. The situation can really be summed up best by a guy we kind of know and have heard of in Missouri. His name was Leonard Wood. Major General Leonard Wood was the commander at Camp Funston. And again, even the military would go out to civilian organizations and ask for help. So in November 1917, he went to a women's group in Topeka, Kansas, and he explained to them what he needed them to do. He said, "Ladies, I need you to visit the camps as often as possible. It doesn't matter if you have a relative or a sweetheart there or not. Boys like to meet those decent women. Soldiers' families need your encouragement. Please help the Red Cross, the YMCA, the YWCA, and the Boy Scouts. Don't overlook those home guards. And don't look down your nose at them because they're doing their duty as well. Also, conserve. That meant to produce as much as you possibly can while eating as little as you can, so the rest could be shared with others for the war effort." Now I have to mention this larger picture on the slide, and this is in Kansas City. It is the 129th Field Artillery on parade. And the ironic thing is that when I checked in to the hotel last night, a picture from the very same day showing this parade was hanging above my bed. Government censorship and control. Now we look back and we almost have to laugh when we read, well, you can't dress extravagantly because that means you're not being a war supporter. I can imagine a lot of women didn't really take too kindly to that kind of verbiage, but Congress passed the Sedition Act on May 16, 1918. And that was following the Espionage Act from 1917. Thus, by May 1918, it was illegal in the United States for any person to convey information intended to interfere with the U.S. Armed Forces. It was aimed at socialists, pacifists, and anyone who was basically anti-war. Penalties were imposed upon individuals, including death, for doing things including insulting or abusing the U.S. government. Not quite sure what that means today. The flag, the Constitution, the military, or agitating against the production of items necessary for war, or advocating, teaching, or defending any of these acts. So propaganda materials were everywhere, every newspaper. And the interesting thing, if you start looking at newspapers in a site like newspapers.com or another online database where you can search by word, you can see where the same articles were repeated or very similar in newspapers across the country. And that was done by the Committee on Public Information, also known as the CPI. It was an independent agency that the government created to control what information went out. So they controlled what information went in the newspapers. And you would see things that would say, as you see here, the "How would Germans stir up strife?" And "Have you met this Kaiserite?" That phrase alone was repeated over 1,100 times in small town newspapers across the United States. You also saw cartoons, news articles, and Even more dramatic, I think, today and difficult for us to understand, our private mail was censored. Not just did they go and read it, they would keep it from being delivered to individuals. The government stopped all delivery of foreign language publications, even if they were printed here in the United States. And for Germans, a lot of Germans that lived in Missouri, that was huge, because one of the largest German language publishers in the world was in Chicago. And if a lot of you have looked through your ancestors' materials, you likely have seen things in German. When you open up that school book, that hymn book, or even that magazine, it likely may have been printed in Chicago. All of that stopped in early 1918. Here are just a few other items that you would have seen. Actually, let me go back for one moment. The light picture that you see behind is the cover of Life magazine from the middle of 1917. On the backside of that same Life magazine was the buy war bonds. But as you can see, everything from your chewing gum to your oranges became patriotic. Our boys were called to serve, but so was everybody who stayed at home. Plant that victory garden, and perhaps that angel will appear magically over your garden. What about the flu? Well, that was the situation when the flu hit, and it basically hit across the planet in three separate waves. Now, you may see different dates in other places, but this is how I divide it up, I'll be honest. And part of this is due to that scientific research I mentioned, but it's also newspaper research when I have looked through, especially in Missouri and surrounding states, how long the epidemic lasted here. So it begins in the early spring of 1918, most likely in Kansas. The first documented case was at Camp Funston on Fort Riley, Kansas. An Army private reported to sick bay early in the morning. By noon, there were 100 cases. By the end of the week, there were 500. Now, 48 of those young men died of influenza, and then it seemed to kind of vanish. It reappeared, however, after the boys landed in Europe. Although the Americans tended not to get sick, it was rather the other Europeans, both the Allies and the Central Powers. The first wave appeared to be highly infectious. However, most recovered rather quickly, and doctors gave it the name of the three-day flu and assumed it was just another variety of influenza, this year's strain, and they really weren't worried about it. But when that second wave starts in August, again, it begins in Europe on the battlefields, it ends in the most lethal 10-week period, really across the globe. It did not move in a solid motion, and that's one of the challenges for scientists, because it hit in different areas at different times. But the second wave spread so quickly that, for example, in one sector of the Western Front, over 70,000 American servicemen became ill and were hospitalized, and almost a third of those died. By the end of the summer, the virus had reached the German army, and in the end, over 400,000 German citizens lose their lives as well. Now, the third wave was less deadly, but it was no less devastating. In the US, because the war effort was the thing, the vital thing driving our lives, the threat was downplayed. And I thought you might enjoy a few of these ads. The one on the far side is, "Eat more onions." That's the best way to ward off the flu, just eat onions. The middle ad with caution on top is an ad for ginger ale. And by the way, ladies, if you need to kiss your fella as he's being put on the troop train, you can simply put a handkerchief between you, the two of you, while you kiss. And lastly, of course, we all know still today, the wonder drug, Vicks Vapor Rub. They ran ads, and it's actually a very long article that I did not include there, but it says that Vicks Vapor Rub should be used only sparingly, unless you have the flu. And then you should use tons of it. So they are saying that they transported 3 million jars of Vicks Vapor Rub to areas that were hardest hit. But I will also draw your attention to the final thing on this slide, and that is, even though they're seeing influenza and people becoming ill and people dying, the number one important thing is the bond drive to keep money going. And this article is, again, just the top of it, but it tells you by state, because of state-by-state competition, who's winning. Who's winning? Right now it's Indiana. Kentucky's second. But we do make the top, don't make me count, six. So Missouri's number six. The disease, however, was overwhelming. And the United States officials didn't always react the best. They didn't always encourage the kinds of methods that would have need to be undertaken in order to control the flu. And I'll give you one example of the US Surgeon General at the time gave his advice on how to avoid getting the flu. And you simply needed to have good bed rest, good health food, good healthy food, quinine, take your quinine, which is an anti-malarial, and aspirin. And finally, U.S. officials also suggested that perhaps it wasn't simply Americans getting sick, but rather the Germans who had and were making Americans sick. So the head of the health and sanitation section of the emergency fleet, and what that means is where they were building ships in New York City, he said, well, I actually think it was the Germans, and it would be, quote, it would be quite easy for one of these German agents to turn loose the Spanish influenza germs in a theater or someplace where large numbers of persons are assembled. The Germans have started epidemics in Europe, you know. And there's no reason why they should be gentle with America. The initial reaction was absolutely, hey, this is just influenza. That's just that simple thing, that little thing that happens once a year. It's seasonal. Some people get sick. Sometimes old people die. But for the most part, it's not that serious. This flu, however, was different. This strain arrived quickly and was extraordinarily deadly. And that means that unlike any other time, 50% of the deaths were the young and healthy, between the ages of 20 and 40 years old. And my grandfather and his first wife, Mary, fit absolutely right into that category. She was 29 when she died. 99% were under the age of 65. What does that mean? The old weren't the ones that were getting sick and dying. Many got ill, but they did not die. And finally, you see the other statistic there that between the ages of 5 and 14, the children had the lowest death rate, precisely the opposite of what normal seasonal flu is. Thus, the symptoms were also crazy, and quite frankly, kind of disgusting. There were a lot of different varying symptoms, everything from bleeding from every orifice in one's body to a complete cyanotic response. And for those of you who don't know, and I didn't know that either, scientists call it an uncontrolled, exuberant immune response. And that meant that the stronger your immune system was to begin with, the more likely it was to turn on you and kill you. And it did that by attacking the virus that was in your lungs, because this was a respiratory disease, and therefore people were actually drowning in their own fluids, and they often turned black or blue. In the early cases, when the young men started dying in military camps on the East Coast, many of the physicians, military physicians, so these are, you know, well-trained doctors, they really thought there was a chance they had the Black Plague. And they said they could not tell the race of many of the dead because of the skin color had changed so dramatically. The other thing was the length of the disease dramatically varied. Some people got sick, as you often do with flu, and were in bed for a week, and then they were fine. Others stayed ill for weeks. Well, yet others, and this is the most striking, and you can imagine the most panic-inducing aspect, was that some simply seemed healthy when they went to work that day, and they were dead by evening. There are actually documented reports, so again, not one of those things where, hey, somebody told me that somebody died in the street, but rather documented reports of individuals that simply were on the street, in public, speaking to another person, normally seemed to be just fine, not sick at all, and simply dropped dead in a moment. That is not our normal experience with flu. And therefore, people truly became afraid. What made things additionally dramatic was the fact that, again, we were supporting that war effort. And in supporting the war effort, we sent our medical personnel to Europe. That means one-third of all U.S. medical personnel in the United States left and were in the European theater. One specific example of that is there were 1,200 doctors registered to practice medicine in Kansas, and half of them were in Europe. That meant there were several counties in Kansas who had no doctor whatsoever. But wartime censorship kept it from the front pages, and that meant that a lot of people realized something bad was happening, but they weren't seeing it in the newspaper and adequately reported. It began to be almost too much for people to deal with. And you will see, if you look at some of the different books and articles, they simply say America began to come apart at the seams. Gatherings were banned across the country. Again, the federal government did not have the same capability they have today. And what that means is that states, but more specifically localities, city by city, town by town, got to decide how they reacted to the flu. Some reacted immediately and well, and were able to control, and not completely quarantine, but at least control the outbreak. Others did not make the same choices. Morticians and grave diggers struggled to keep up and to keep ahead, because conducting individual funerals became banned. It was considered a public gathering, and you could not have more than 6 people at a graveside service. What saved us was nurses. Quite honestly, nurses, the organized nursing corps, as well as individuals who took up the mantle, were really the ones that saved many, many, many people. The picture on the bottom here is of St. Louis. And those are volunteer nurses. That one you can see, it looks actually like an official ambulance, but many of them were private individuals who drove their own vehicles. And that meant that people, while people were afraid, they came out to help one another. And the Red Cross and other organizations in cities across this country began to organize what they called the home nursing, which meant that individuals went to help people, because it's so hard to imagine today that people were dying so quickly and becoming ill so quickly and staying ill that in one family, in one household, you might have one or two or three or more adults that were ill, unable to care for themselves, and certainly unable to care for others. And they might also have a corpse of someone who'd already died in their house. There was a shortage of coffins, and there was certainly a shortage of people willing to help to deal with the dead and the dying. So globally today, we believe there was as many as 50 million to 100 million individuals who perished from influenza. The reason we don't have a precise number is that simply a lot of reporting is not accurate. As you can imagine, even today, sometimes it's hard to get excellent and very precise statistics. You can imagine when this kind of thing is happening, it's very difficult to worry about statistics and to do proper reporting and fill out government paperwork. In most countries, influenza was not a reportable illness in 1918. And what does that mean? That means even if you were treated by a doctor for the flu, he didn't have to tell anybody. He didn't have to file a report or inform anyone else. So the information wasn't very accurate about how the disease spread, nor especially early on, who died and how many died. The amazing number, however, is that one-third of every single person on Earth was sickened with influenza. And that 10-week period in September to November of 1918, in that fall, included a great number of those people, meaning that was the most difficult time. Many people believed it could indeed be the end of days. No one knew when it would end. I list just a couple of countries here. You can find in some of those items that I gave to you in the bibliography more numbers, but let me just give you a couple statistics. Again, it was not even, and sometimes it was unexpected, and that means an island country like Fiji, which is a very small island in the South Pacific, 14% of its population died in 2 weeks. India lost as many as 17 million people, and Indonesia 1.5 million. In the United States, 675,000 deaths occurred. And again, it's probably a little higher than that, but that number is where most scientists believe it is. So today, that's where we stand. In Missouri, we lost almost 18,000 people in this state alone. And you'll see the list of other states, we were higher. We were higher than a lot of states. And the reason for that, it depends on who you ask. But certainly some of it had to do with response, how we responded, because each locality, again, got to make their own choices, how they did that, how they responded. So looking at the difference between Kansas City and St. Louis is rather stark. Twenty-1,000 Missourians were ill in that period between early 1918 and mid-1920. And by 1920, almost 18,000 had died. Now in St. Louis, the city hospital treated almost 18,000 cases alone, one hospital in St. Louis, and they lost 3,200 of those. But that number is dramatic. Can you imagine any hospital, especially in those days? We're not talking about the mega hospitals that we see today. That is not the kind of infrastructure that existed in 1918. The death rate in Kansas City by population was far higher. From Kansas City, part of the problem, part of the reason its death count was higher by, per capita, is because it was affected by a couple of the different waves. And that means if you look at the newspapers, you will see that at times the bans are lifted, it was a daily count in the newspaper. On that front page, by this time, you would see only 38 dead today, but there are 250 new cases. You would see those numbers every single day. And any time it went down by between 10 and 50 people, they would begin to open and really think, oh, we're almost over it, we're almost through it. And so they would begin to lighten up and allow churches to open for services. They would allow funerals to occur. And almost invariably, the next day, the numbers skyrocketed again. I grew up in Christian County, and I'm one of those people who likes to sit in the evening and look on the death certificate database on the State Historical Society digital Missouri page. Yes, my husband loves me. this is an unscientific study, of course, but of the death certificates in the database for Christian County, of individuals who became ill or who died between September 1918 and April 1919, there were 89 deaths, and over half of those were from flu or flu complications. In Boone County, which is where the University of Missouri in Columbia is, there were 150 deaths in Columbia alone. And Morgan County, also where a fairly small and rural county, of those death certificates again, about 52% was the number for them, which is, again, extremely high, extremely high. At the University of Missouri in Columbia, there were 5 buildings that were used as temporary hospitals. The university itself had a single hospital. It was called the Parker Memorial Hospital, and it was so overwhelmed they had to close to anyone other than students or staff. They treated over 1,000 cases of influenza at the university hospital alone. And the university, again, it's one of those cases where I really looked at the wave and the length of time. Columbia got hit by that later wave, which means in January 1920, the newspapers were filled again with stories of influenza filling the hospitals in Columbia. And by the end of January, the sorority houses were being used for temporary hospitals. One of the most interesting sources, I think, on influenza, if those of you are familiar with the PBS series, The American Experience. The American Experience did a special on the 1918 influenza epidemic in, I believe, the late 90s. And they interview people who survived it, as well as to give you a historic context. And one of the interesting stories is by a gentleman who was a young man at the time, really a small child, and his mother became ill, and he was made to leave the house, and he went and stayed with the ugly old aunt he didn't like. Well, he got sick too, and he was in bed on the second floor just above the stairway, and he heard the phone ring one day, and his aunt answered the phone, and she said, "Oh dear, oh no, well, if you really want me to, I'll tell him." And he said, she didn't have to tell me anything. I knew that the light had gone out of our lives. And that meant that his mother had passed away. You saw that first picture at the opening slide was of Carl Siegel and his first wife. This is probably in 1919, 1920 timeframe. And you can see it's just not quite as shiny. There's not a big smile on his face, and his three boys no longer have their mother. As I mentioned, we now believe as many as 1 million people died across the globe. And if we compare that to those that were killed in the war, civilians as well as troops, that was 20 million. If you add together for Americans the casualties, the deaths from World War I and World War II, pandemic influenza outpaces it dramatically. A lot of people suffered from after effects, and I mean by that everything from extended illnesses to heart problems and dementia in the years to come. And rather dramatically, across the United States, again, a lot of companies do statistics, they do reports, and the insurance companies, many of which barely escaped going completely out of business, the life expectancy of Americans due to the war and due to pandemic influenza dropped by 12 years. That, I think, is an amazing number when you think that the death life expectancy used to be about 65. Can you imagine it dropping to 53? And that's a statistic overall, but that's because of that great loss of life we suffered. There were a lot of businesses that suffered too because they had to close. Grocery stores, theaters, all kinds of businesses were affected. In Little Rock, Arkansas, for example, businesses reported that between year to year, from 1918 even to 1919, they lost as much as 70% of their business. And one third of the city's grocery stores closed permanently. The average business loss in the city was reported to be $10,000 a day during the height of the epidemic. It's rather hard to imagine how difficult it was, but it truly was a rapid, quickly arriving, and devastating pandemic. There's a lot of discussion among scientists, and they often talk about why we don't see a lot of mention about the flu, about this epidemic, in public history, in history books. Why don't we all already know about influenza? And I think the words on the top of this slide are simply the reason. The war was so devastating with the influenza on top of it. A lot of people just wanted to put it behind them. And it still exists there in their private memories, in letters, in their hearts, but it is not as prevalent in what we consider our collective memory. And with that, I think I'll close out and open it up for questions. If there is anything that you'd like to ask,
I guess I'll be the first. So you had talked, your slide said in September through November of 19 was one of the worst hard hit sections of the period. That's harvest season.
Yes.
So what happened to the nation and the international food supply when farmers are off fighting war and now you've got further shortages in harvesters and family farms?
It was rather dramatic. It truly was, because you had so many people that were simply sick, even if you discount those who actually died. The amount of people that were ill, a lot of the crops simply never left the field. And it was truly felt in 1919.
I don't have a question, but I have a comment. I have my undergraduate and graduate degrees from the University of Missouri, Columbia, and I've always been fascinated by the Memorial Union Arch, which was constructed in honor and or rather in memory of all of the University of Missouri students who perished as soldiers in World War I. Mm-hmm. However, I'm from a small community, Brunswick, Missouri, west of Moberly, and I always knew that the American Legion Post was named the Rucker McAllister Post. Rucker for the only son of a prominent family in Brunswick, and McAllister for a man who perished in the European front from Menden, Missouri. All right, so I always walk through the Memorial Union and I could see Lubbock Ray Rucker. I can tell you right where it is. Mm-hmm. So I did some investigating. He died of the flu epidemic. He never fought in the war. And I would like to someday determine how many of the names that are there on the arch never were in the front. That's all. Thank you.
One of the interesting things, again, is that aside from military records, the university has a substantial record collection. But one of the most interesting things I've found, and you can access it online and it's in your bibliography list, is the Savitar from 1919. Because the first page, first of all, they're beautiful. They're hand-inked, beautiful portraits. But when you open it up initially, it's the soldier coming back and dedicating it to the soldiers. But there are two separate lists in there that are of interest. One of them is in memorandum, and there are just a few names on that list, and I would assume they were either Savitar staff or people that were well known on campus who died of the flu. They also, however, have a list of all the soldiers. And again, it does not say in memorandum, so it would be interesting to compare that list that's in the Savitar to those on the arch. It's also an interesting source because they have the Red Cross auxiliary staff there, which are the nurses. One of the things I didn't mention is because the medical staff was so limited that they begged anyone with any kind of medical knowledge to come help. And so that meant that they actually closed down the medical school and the nursing school, and those that were nurses or in nursing training were included in that home health care, even though they had not yet graduated and were not officially nurses. And they had two different pictures with all of the individuals named with those. And the third thing was the Army Training Corps, which was called the SATC, which later became ROTC. But in that era, it was the Student Army Training Corps. And they have those pictures and the story. And the final one I'll mention about Mizzou is that if any of you are interested in trivia, there is only one year that since the college was in existence and had a football team, that they did not play football. And it was the only school in the Midwest that was not able to play a single game. And again, it was just because of how they were hit. So there's also a beautiful hand-inked cartoon in there showing a doughboy soldier standing in front of the Mizzou, not the columns, but the arch, at the gates with a sign that says closed for football.
One other quick thing. There is a rule of thumb for anyone who goes beneath the arch. If a man is wearing a hat or cap, mm-hmm. taken off and no one is to talk, speak. That rule is not used anymore.
Yes. Right. And what she said was that when you go under the arch in Memorial Union, men are supposed to take off their caps, and no one is to speak in order to honor those who lost their lives. And as she pointed out, I'm quite sure that that doesn't happen today.
Kids these days. I had a aunt. I guess you could call her my aunt. She's my dad's older sister. She was killed by this epidemic in 1918. Here in Kansas City, Kansas. But my question is, did you ever give any thought to why an epidemic like this didn't start in that war 2 or 3 years earlier? I mean, no army has ever went through the same conditions as those soldiers did in World War I. Bad food, bad officers, absolutely no medical care. They lived in trenches with water, frozen water, clear up to their hips.
Right.
And why didn't an epidemic, do you think, why didn't this happen, something like this happen, years before it happened in 1918?
Can I tell you that that question drives scientists crazy? And I'm not a scientist, but I will tell you that this particular epidemic is one of the most studied things in science, because it absolutely drives people crazy that they can't understand why it started. And there are many different theories. Jonathan and I were talking about one of the best books written. It was about 10 years ago. I think it was published in 2008. It may have been a little bit earlier, but it's by John Barry, and he did a beautiful job of covering the epidemic. But at that time, even his numbers in that book are much lower than, well, I'm sorry, it's, I think he talks about between 30 and 60 million. But also at that time, the best theory that it did indeed come from to Camp Funston from Haskell County, Kansas, but they believed at that time that it came from pigs to humans. And now scientists have pretty much proved that that's not the case. The story about how they have figured some of this out scientifically, quite honestly, even though I'm not into biology or science, is really amazing. And that is, you know, I'd love to tell you, but it's kind of long, so I won't be able to tell you today. But I will tell you that if you will read a couple of those later news articles, you will understand a little bit about what scientists have done. And the short version is simply they have been able to genetically determine what the influenza virus from 1918 looks like, and they now call it H1N1. So when you hear that, or you hear H1N2 or H2N1, those are variants, but H1N1 is the grandmother, and that is the 1918 influenza. And they have now been able to tell what it looks like in terms of its genes, but they do not know exactly why it infected humans at that particular time. And there are different theories about even, Kansas is the prevailing one, but there are scientific studies that individuals got sick in China, individuals got sick in Russia, and individuals got sick in France, perhaps simultaneously or very early on. And obviously, if it's a single disease, getting sick simultaneously is, you know, across the earth is a little bit dramatic. So they haven't figured out, and quite honestly, most scientists will tell you, including the head of the CDC recently said, I don't think we will ever know exactly where it started and why.
So your answer to his question covered 80% of what I was going to ask you about. Okay. We'll just let it go. I'll just make a couple observations. I volunteer regularly. In terms of censorship, there were over 500 German language publications in 1918, and they all got shut down by the Sedition Act, and none of them reopened. You know, yeah. They just vanished. And the other thing is that here in the museum, we have a list where it says on the wall, 20 million people died from the influenza. And it's just worth pointing out, that's what's called excess deaths. That's deaths over
right.
what you would
right.
expect. But the worldwide number, like you say, is probably closer to 100 million. I've read in other books that the estimates for India alone are somewhere between 12 and 30 million.
Yes.
Because no one's going to ride influenza. They just bury people and move on.
So. And we have almost no numbers from China, which even then was the largest country on the planet. So China is one of the biggest factors and the biggest reasons why you're seeing that 100 million.
Is there a general view among historians about the role the flu played in bringing the war to a close sooner, perhaps, rather than later?
I'm not sure if there's agreement, but I will tell you what I know, and that is simply that the last major German offensive was planned for the summer of 1918, and it had to be delayed by almost 6 weeks because of the illness in the ranks. And the other thing that of note on our side is that when it was clear that the epidemic was spreading through U.S. military troops, President Woodrow Wilson was asked, "Do you want us to keep sending them to Europe?" And almost in tears, he turned away, looked away from them, and nodded his head. That means they were very afraid that they could not get the Germans to capitulate. And in order to do so, he knew he had to put them on ships and keep sending them in large numbers. Even those who never reached a battlefield, they knew there was no news story, and it didn't happen until after November, troop ships were not turned around at any time. And the death and illness on the troop ships was dramatic. The situation, I mean, a lot of troops were buried at sea because they had no other option. Also, they tried to quarantine those that were sick, but anyone who's had the flu knows that you are infectious long before you realize it. So they let troops off of the ships who did not feel or had no symptoms, and yet those symptoms quickly were found in other troops because, of course, some of them were carrying influenza.
We're going to take our last question up here.
Thank you. This has been very informative. Perhaps your comment about a healthy autoimmune response explains it, but can you discuss a little bit why young children did not get it, or did not die, and the elderly did not die, but young, healthy people died at a much greater rate?
Well, and it's interesting because there's one theory that I have read about the elderly, and that was the last major influenza epidemic in the United States that was really severe was 1890. And so they believe that there was a chance that there were a lot of people that had been at least exposed to that, if not had actually been sickened by it. And so some people might have had a resistance to at least part of that, because as you know, influenza, it's just like a human. It gets part of each of its genes from a different part. So that's why the 1918 one is unique. But they believe that there's a possibility that some individuals who had been exposed to it would have been more able to not become ill in 1918. That does not answer the question of why young children did not die. And it is unclear at this point. To my knowledge, I haven't seen anything. I'm sure there are a lot of scientific studies. And I will also mention that I know I'm not a scientist, as I mentioned, and it's sometimes challenging to read scientific studies, but because there is such an interest in influenza, both in the scientific and the history community, there are a lot of scientific studies online. And if you can get through a little of the science, it's very interesting to look at what populations they've looked at and how they came upon their conclusions. And for example, in the bibliography, I cite the example of a St. Joe, Missouri study where, you know, a scientist has really gone through, kind of like I did a little bit on the death certificates, but he's gone through the newspapers, he's gone through all the local medical reports and everything he could come up with to look specifically at what happened in St. Joe. There are a lot of examples with that, so I encourage you, if there's a particular area that you're interested in, it could be that there is a study that was done, but I don't know why young children were not, and I believe that scientists do not have an answer to that.
On behalf of the National World War I Museum Memorial, thank you everyone for joining us, and a thank you to Michelle Spencer.